Well, this morning, and in light of all that's been transpiring and going on in our nation in this week, I wanted to focus our attention on something eternal. And, you know, I don't want to make a political commentary. I don't want to make any political statements because there are many other people that are much smarter than me, that have much more stronger opinions and have already made their presence and their ideas known. But what I want us to do today is I want to have a dose of realism. I want to have a dose of realism today. What is real, what is eternal, and what is temporary? And I want us to focus on what is eternal. You know, God has never needed any kingdom of the earth, any man's government or any man's authority for the church to flourish. In fact, the church has generally flourished under persecution. God has not needed a political party, a president, a leader for the church to flourish, for the kingdom to expand and to grow. In fact, if you look in China, which has suffered decades of atheistic communist rule, the church in China is the biggest body of believers anywhere in the world. It's expanded under communist rule. God is continuing to build his church as Jesus promised he would do. Chuck Colson was right when he said, "The kingdom of God will not arrive on Air Force One, no matter who's occupying it." God is still on the throne. So this continues our two-part series. I'm focusing on weakness. You can say, well, how does that apply? Well, the church always appears weak, and God uses it mightily for his purposes. The church always appears to be downtrodden when God is working his greatest work, and he's powerfully using and moving through the church. You know, we've seen a transition of power in Washington, D.C., and we've seen a transition of leadership, and arguably to the position of the greatest power of any leader in the world today. But what happened to us? What happened to us the next day? The sun came up. For those of us that needed, we made coffee. We opened our Bibles. We spent time with the Lord. We went to work. The day carried on. God is still on the throne. Nothing has changed. You know, the seasons of national change, of transition of power, these huge seismic shifts politically, we must always take a step back and as followers of Jesus realize that we belong to a different kingdom. We belong to a different kingdom. If you're a follower of Jesus, someone has given his life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, you belong to a different kingdom. Yes, we are citizens of the United States of America. We reside in America, but we belong to another kingdom, an eternal kingdom. That's where our allegiance and our faith lies, our trust in that kingdom. You know, in the book of Revelation, John's revelation, and he sees the four living creatures, and he sees the 24 elders worshiping and singing this song in Revelation chapter 5. And he says, and they sang a new song saying, "Worthy are you," speaking about Jesus, "worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe, language, and people, and nation." And then verse 10, "And you have made them a kingdom of priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth." That's the kingdom that we belong to. That's the kingdom where we reside. That's the kingdom we serve. Yes, we do serve the United States of America. We live in the United States of America, but our eternal kingdom is this kingdom. Those who have given their lives to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. You know, my goal today is to take our eyes off of Washington, off the temporal, and to gaze at the eternal, to focus on the eternal, that which is unchanging. And to see, well, our dependency and our faith has to be placed in God. There is no other security that we have. Paul says this in the verse that we looked at last week. In 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9, as Jesus is speaking to him, my grace is sufficient for you. For my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly in my weakness, that the power of Christ might rest on me. And I didn't mention that last week, but what does it mean to that beautiful picture of the power of Christ resting on me? You know, when we think of power, we think of, well, I'm going to plug into a socket and get some energy, or I'm going to, get power somehow and exercise that. But we never really think of the power of God just resting like a cloak on us. God's power through Jesus Christ is resting on us. Today we're going to look at Psalm 146. And it's interesting, we were singing, and we're going to sing a little further about Psalm 46, but Psalm 146 is really pertinent for this age and this time that we're in. I love the Psalms. They're so good for devotions, for worship, for focusing our attention, because they get to the heart of man. They get to where we really are in our heart. So open your Bibles with me to Psalm 146. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will sing. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. Put not your trust in princes, in a son of man in whom there is no salvation. When his breath departs, he returns to the earth, and on that very day his plans perish. Blessed is he whose help is in the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoner free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the sojourners. He upholds the widow and the fatherless. But the way of the wicked he brings to ruin. The Lord will reign forever. Your God, O Zion, to all generations, praise the Lord. Amen. You know, we don't know the exact time and the authorship of the psalm, but early Greek scholars and some of the early manuscripts, they refer to it as being a psalm of Zechariah or Haggai. So it was around that time in history. And if you're not familiar with that, when the history of those two prophets, it was around the time of Nehemiah, a time where Nehemiah was bringing back the children of Israel to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. They were returning from exile and from Babylon, and there was a seismic shift taking place in the land. Many different things were happening at the same time. Jerusalem was being rebuilt. The people were refocusing their worship on the one true God. They were going from being a people of exile to being a free people once again. And the psalm begins and ends with the phrase, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now, out of that, we get the Hebrew word is hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And in fact, I mentioned this in the earlier service, that in the reflexive form of the verb in the Hebrew, now it sounds like I'm really intelligent, I don't know what that means, but that's what the book says. The reflexive form of the verb, hallelujah, means to be out of your mind, to be crazy, and literally to praise God to the form of saying, I'm out of my mind in worshiping God. Now, when we worship God, to those around us who don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, it looks like we're out of our mind. For one, standing, looking at the sky, raising your hands and worshiping someone you cannot see, hallelujah. I'm out of my mind, but I worship the one true God who reigns forever. We worship God. When was the last time you were lost in worship? When was the last time you were completely lost and abandoned in worship to God? I love seeing our worship team, and I'm going to pick on Gulnara. I just love when Gulnara worships. She just is lost in the presence of God and loves to worship. It's a beautiful thing. It's hallelujah. What a great perspective. We're invited into that daily. We're invited into that kind of worship daily. But then the psalm seems to take an abrupt turn in verse 3 and 4. Obviously, something was happening in the political arena at that time that was causing the people to question who they really could trust. And verse 3 says, "Put not your trust in princes, in a son of man in whom there is no salvation. When his breath departs, he returns to the earth. On that very day, his plans perish." You know, people put their trust in all kinds of things. Right now, you're putting your trust in that chair you're sitting on. But we put our trust in all kinds of things. We put our trust in the stock markets. We put our trust in our 401k. We put our trust in the military to protect us. We put our trust in our family relationships. But overwhelmingly, the one thing that people put their trust in is a prominent leader. Someone that they feel, yes, that person gets me. I can trust him or her to take care of me, to provide for me. We overwhelmingly, as people, as human beings, trust leaders. And often to our detriment, we do that. But that's what we do. We put our trust in people. People, when we realize it, are just weak and broken, just as we are, in need of a Savior. Verse 3 refers to a son of man in whom there is no salvation. Now we mustn't get confused with that. Jesus refers to himself as the son of man over 80 times in the Gospels. This is not what he's talking about here, the psalmist is talking about here. It's not referring to Jesus. This is the old covenant. This is before Jesus came. And literally means an ordinary man. An ordinary, average human being. In fact, the NASB, the New American Standard Bible, says, "Do not trust in mortal man." And to further clarify, we shouldn't put our trust in that person, because the psalmist says, when he dies, everything that he planned, everything that he prepared, all the ideas he had, they die with him. They go with him. Life is fleeting. Life goes by very quickly. Life is fleeting, and nobody has the guarantee of their next breath. Do you realize that? You said, "Trust me," but there's no guarantee in anyone having their next breath. Woody Allen, I don't often quote, in fact, never quote Woody Allen in the sermon, but he says, "I don't want to achieve immortality through my work. I want to achieve immortality by not dying." That's kind of the desire of people who don't know Jesus Christ is Lord. They're desperate to achieve some kind of immortality. You know, I suggest a really good exercise is to step back. Step back from everything that's happening on around you in your life and think about, where do you put your trust? Where do you put your trust? The frailty of humanity will always let you down. No matter who the leader is, they will let you down. Mankind is frail. But then the psalmist goes on and begins praising God again and says, "Blessed is he," in verse 5, "blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God." You know, I want to encourage you that putting your hope, your trust, your faith in God is not simply a good thing. There's a blessing in that. It's not just focusing on eternity. People say, "Well, I put my faith in Jesus and I'm glad because I'm going to go to heaven one day and spend eternity with God." What he's saying, though, is if your hope and your trust in God is there's a blessing for today, for your daily life, you are blessed by putting your faith in God and no one else. You know, we use that term, trust Jesus for our salvation. I trust Jesus for my salvation. And yes, that's okay, that's right. But I prefer the term of giving Jesus the lordship over my life. He is Lord over my life. He's directing my path. And then I trust him for the daily provision. I trust him for guidance. I trust him for wisdom. That's daily trusting God. And then life is blessed. You'll be blessed if your help is from God, if your hope is in him alone. The acid test really is how you responded to Wednesday. That's the acid test of where your trust is in. If you were despondent and fearful, if you were saying, "Woe is me, I don't know what the future looks like," your hope might be in the wrong person. But But if you're excited and you're saying, yes, I'm really passionate about the future, I'm really excited with who is in Washington, your hope might be in the wrong person. Either way, your hope might be in the wrong person. The psalmist says that there's only one that we should put our trust in, and that's the uncreated creator of all of the universe. Not only did he create it, he sustains it. He's intimately involved in the direction of every atom in the universe all at once. That's the one we worship. That's the one we trust. And in fact, that's the one that gives President Biden his breath every day. That's the one we serve. The Creator God is not simply the Creator who set all things in motion, and says, verse 6 says, he keeps faith forever. He keeps faith forever. Our God is eternally faithful. I challenge you to find me a Christian who's been walking with the Lord for many years, someone in their 80s who says, God let me down. You will never find that person. God is faithful. King David testified to this in Psalm 37. He says, I have been young and now I'm old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken or his children begging for bread. You can trust God. He is faithful. Always. You know, the next three verses, 7, 8, and 9, the psalmist lists eight oppressed or suffering groups of people. Those that the world often overlooks. Those are the minorities that the world wishes would just kind of go away. They're a burden sometimes. But God sees them. God brings relief. Starting at verse 7, the Lord executes justice for the oppressed. The Lord feeds the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoners free, possibly referring to the exiles coming back from Babylon, or maybe even going back to the Exodus out of Egypt. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind, possibly referring to those who have spiritually blinded eyes, to be able to see the truth. The Lord raises up those who are bowed down, those who are weighed down by the heavy cares and the worries of this world. The Lord lifts them up. He raises them up. The Lord watches over the sojourner and the foreigner. The New American Standard Bible says, the Lord protects the stranger. The Lord cares for and supports the orphan and the widow. These are all things that no human leader can offer. Sure, they may mention them in campaign speeches, but they cannot offer that, what God can only do. Only God can care for all of the people in these categories at once. Our God is the one who cares. He cares for the weak. He cares for the helpless. Our God is the one that sees everybody and knows their situations intimately. As we saw last week, God uses the weak things of this world for his glory, for his power. When we are weak, then he is strong. God uses that. Paul the apostle knew this in 1 Corinthians 1:27. He says, but God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. The kingdom of God is empowered. The kingdom of God on this earth is empowered when weakness steps up in faith and says, I will go. I will step forward. That's when we see the power of God on display. Not when we have any strength, but when he uses us for his glory. You know, after Hurricane Katrina struck in 2005, I was very involved in some of the relief efforts over the next few years. And we took a team down right after, as many of you know, the city was flooded for a little over 2 weeks. 80% of the city was flooded for over 2 weeks. And when the waters were pumped out and people were able to come back in to help, over 10,000 people had stayed behind. 10,000 people were somehow surviving in the midst of those terrible situations. And so what we did was, with our mission teams, the initial teams that went in, is we simply had an old beaten up 16-passenger van, and we'd take meals in, and we'd drive around handing out meals to people working on their houses, people just trying to pull together some of their belongings. And so we were handing out food and praying for people and sharing the gospel with people. And it was obviously a very, very difficult time. And at that time, FEMA and the National Guard says no one under the age of 16 is allowed to come into the city. They had very strict guidelines. Well, I went on a trip down with Debbie, and Christy was 3 years old. I said, well, we're not leaving her at home. We're taking her with us. And being one that always loves to follow the rules, I said, just kind of lie low. So if we go past the National Guard's checkpoint, just kind of keep your head down. And so we took her in. And what became something that we thought initially was potentially a hindrance or something we were afraid of, or how is she going to respond to seeing this, became one of the greatest blessings. She took it upon herself, as we were handing out food, to hand out the plastic silverware and the little cups of dessert to people. And she'd run between homes and the van, making sure everybody got what they needed. And then she'd give people hugs and she'd tell them, Jesus loves you. The response was overwhelming. People broke down and wept that this little girl came to care for them and help them. And it broke down barriers of fear. It broke down barriers of suspicion. It broke down barriers of racism. As you see, we have that is a house on top of a car. That one of the pictures that we have at that time. But here was this seemingly weak person that had such a powerful impact in that area of devastation, breaking through where no one else could do, because the power of God was on display through someone that was weak. God took the weak and the seemingly inconvenient and used it for His glory, for His power. As we come to the end of the song, it seems that the writer then takes this abrupt turn in the second part of verse 9 and says, but the way of the wicked He brings to ruin. You always have to remember that God is a God of justice. He is not mocked. He defends the weak. He always brings the wicked to justice. God is consistent. It may not be in the timing we like, in the same way God doesn't always break through in helping the poor and the orphans and the widows in the timing that we like, but God always is faithful, and He is just as faithful in His justice, bringing about justice. That in itself is a scary thought. God is not mocked. He is to be worshipped. The psalm closes in verse 10 with a final triumphant hallelujah. The Lord will reign forever. Your God, O Zion, to all generations, praise the Lord. That triumphant declaration, kind of mirroring what Sharon read earlier in Psalm 46, 6 and 7. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters His voice. He utters His voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. I love that. You know, man is screaming and raging. There's so much noise, clamoring going on around us. God simply utters His voice. And the earth melts before Him. What a declaration of the majesty of God. God is still on the throne. God is still on the throne. He's working out all positions, all things that we see in the world around us. I'm not just talking about America at the moment. If you read what's happening in Moscow, there was huge uprisings and riots that took place just this last few days. Other parts of the world, there are things happening all over the world, and God is at work bringing about His glory for His purposes. For the Christian, for the followers of Jesus, nothing has changed. Our mission has not changed. Our purpose has not changed. We are called to be His light in the world, the salt and the light of the earth. We are called to be His ambassadors, His hands and His feet for the kingdom that we serve. The calling on your life does not change when the political winds of society change. It remains the same. The mission of the church has not changed. There's a quote, He who is over all and through all and in all can handle all. That's the God that we serve. Do you trust in the faithfulness of God today? Do you trust in the faithfulness of God? Or are you guilty of putting your trust in man? Joe Biden is the president, is our president right now, but Jesus Christ is our King. He is the King of kings and Lord of lords, the only one King that will reign forever and ever. He is our King. He's the only one that makes perfect decisions. And he is the only one that's able to absolutely deliver on his promises. And his word is full of promises. And we can trust him. He is the only one that has the power to transform this world. That's Jesus Christ. Are you trusting King Jesus today? Are you trusting King Jesus today? If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I'd love to pray with you. I'd love to pray with you to introduce you to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, putting your faith and your trust in him and him alone. He is the only one who died for you. He's the only one that suffered for you on the cross, that shed his blood for the forgiveness of your sins. He is the only one that was buried in the tomb and God raised him from the dead. He's the only one that ascended into heaven to intercede for you daily. And he's the only one that's coming back again to rule and to reign in righteousness. That's the King of Kings that I serve. Are you trusting the King of Kings today? As we close, I want to invite you. We have a wonderful blessing again in the chapel every week. I invite you, if the Lord has been speaking to you today, I'd love to pray with you. But we have Gulnara and Brett and some others will be up in the chapel and invite you. If the Lord is speaking to you and is stirring in your heart, just go and spend some time up there right after the service. I know that we have our discussion time and then we move the tables around and it's easy to forget. But take advantage of that. Just spend some time with the Lord, processing your feelings, processing where your trust is, and allowing God to minister to you. If you want prayer, they'll pray for you, but you can go and just sit there with your Bible and allow God to minister to you. So I invite you to do that as we close the service. Let's pray together. Lord Almighty, Heavenly Father, we worship you. Hallelujah. King of Kings, Lord Jesus Christ, we worship you. Give you praise and glory and majesty. We praise you that you are on the throne. We praise you for what you're doing. Even when we do not see it around us, we know you're at work and we trust you, God. And we praise you. Lord, we pray for our nation. We pray for an awakening. We pray for our nation to be brought to repentance. Lord, that your followers would stand up boldly and declare the gospel in love. Lord, we pray for our president. We pray for President Biden and his cabinet. We pray, Lord, for the House and the Congress and the Senate. Lord, we pray for you to move. We pray for you to move in power to help them to make wise decisions. But Lord, we know that you are in control. We trust in you, God. We trust what you are doing. And Lord, we pray for our response in these days, that you would give us wisdom. But Lord, above all, I pray that as we respond, we would respond in love to our neighbors, to our co-workers. We would respond with grace because we know that we serve a greater agenda than a temporary agenda. We serve an eternal kingdom. We praise you and glorify you, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh,
woven to the sea, the nations wait. I know my God is in control. The oceans roar, you are the Lord of all. The water comes, the wind that waves, and makes my heart be still. Though the waves wave and mountains move into the sea, the nations wait. I love my